Despite the much-needed win over Carlisle, tempers frayed at the Goldstone. At the final whistle, hundreds of fans invaded the pitch and then stormed the director's box. Seats were ripped up and glass doors shattered. One person was arrested. Police barricaded.
Well, we're around about 5 minutes of this game still to go. There are probably now more fans on the outside than there are on the inside.
At one stage, protesters succeeded in blocking the main A27 road. Several hundred later forced their way into the ground, spilling onto the pitch at half-time.
We want our shirts! And we want our shirts! And we want our shirts!
There is no future for this club with Bill Archer here.
The 26th of April 1997. That was the day the Albion said a very reluctant goodbye to the Goldstone Ground, their home for 95 years. While the fans took what they could to remind them of home, Albion's new owners were striving to keep the club in existence. If we'd lost the following week in that final game of the season at Hereford, who knows what might have happened. As it was, Robbie Rineout rescued the point that Albion needed to stay in the Football League, and Chairman Dick Knight could start looking to the future.
It was my intention to get the club back to Brighton absolutely as soon as possible.
The next 2 years playing at Priestfield were a terrible slog, a round trip of 150 miles. Not for the last time the supporters showed astonishing dedication. Then in 1999, the homecoming. Withdean was never going to be a great place to play football, but it was only meant to be temporary. Nobody could ever have imagined the problems the club would have getting permission for a proper ground to be built. Thankfully, the Amex was well worth the wait. 12 long years we spent here, but I'll tell you one thing, it was never boring. 4 promotions.
We've done something unique, something special.
2 great escapes.
A little bit of confidence, a little bit of self-belief. Win a football match and things can change so quickly.
Some astounding matches.
That Man City game with everything.
The Sheffield United game was amazing.
And the most momentous battle for a new stadium that England's ever seen.
I never, ever gave up.
So now for the authentic viewing experience, why not push the telly back as far as it'll go, maybe pop on the old plastic poncho for one last time, and with the help of those that made it happen, we can relive the Withdean years. It was August 1999 when the fans first watched the Seagulls from these seats. But the battle to bring the Albion back to Brighton had begun long before, when the club was in exile at Gillingham. All the time they were stuck at Priestfield, Albion could never prosper. The men who'd saved the club knew it would be a short-lived reprieve unless they could find a new home. Withdean seemed to be the only solution.
We looked at a number of sites. We talked to the cricket club about sharing with them again. We talked to the Greyhound Stadium, and I came here. And I can remember I came with a friend of mine, and we looked at this site. It obviously had possibilities, but it was a crumbling athletics track. Quite clearly didn't comply with any of the safety standards that we would need to meet. And I just looked at it and I said, can we do it? And she said to me, you've got to. You've got no choice. If this club is going to survive, you have got to bring them back here.
While there were thousands desperate to see the club return, there were plenty too in leafy Withdean who didn't want a football club on their doorstep.
That did take us by surprise, the opposition. It took Steve Bassam, who was the leader of the council at that time, it took him by surprise. But we then realised what we were up against.
To put a fair bit of pressure on people to sort of say, well, look, you know, this is an opportunity, and the football club itself is a bonus to the city rather than a negative. But Withing residents weren't happy. A lot of Conservative colleagues on the council were very unhappy because they sort of had a rather blighted image of football fans. But I think it's worked out really well, actually.
On a smaller scale, this battle set the template for years to come. The Bring Home the Albion campaign fought hard to win over residents and councillors. And with planning permission granted, work could begin on turning the ramshackle stadium into an arena acceptable for league football. It took 6 months.
The transformation from the old rundown stadium to a league football ground was almost magical.
At the same time, the campaign was already underway for a permanent home in the city. Nobody realised quite how long that journey would be. On the 7th of August 1999, Withdean staged its first league game, hosting Mansfield Town. Brighton had a football club again.
That was very emotional, going to Withdean, and it was a renaissance, a way of suddenly forgetting everything that had happened before. We were back.
Had it been a move straight from the Goldstone to Withdean, it might have been different, but this was coming from 2 years in exile at Gillingham. So to be at Withdean was fantastic. The club were back home.
And what a homecoming. Albion romped to a 6-0 victory with Brighton-born Darren Freeman netting a hat-trick on his debut. You couldn't make it up.
When I was very young, I used to go out to Goldstone and watch Brighton over Albion. And, you know, I used to, every time they got the ball, I used to pretend it was myself one day and things like that. So it was almost a dream. And then obviously, you know, later on, there I was playing for Brighton over Albion, my hometown. The fans were fantastic, and, you know, I've got great memories.
Record company Skint was now Albion's aptly named shirt sponsor, thanks to Norman Cook.
Absolute pride, and very much a kind of Brighton-centric thing, because Skint was a Brighton label, and we were very proud of being kind of not having to, you know, kowtow to the music business in London and having our own little thing in Brighton. And there's the same kind of feeling with the team at that point. You know, everything was against us, but we were struggling on.
Even after the fantastic start, the ground would still take some getting used to. The largely open stands and running track made it unusual for fans and players alike.
Coming to the Withdean, it was an experience to start with. Kind of liked the look of the pitch because it was small, so that suited me.
You knew there was going to be a lack of atmosphere. That was perfectly obvious, but it helped us. It's helped the club. I think I was obviously had good years and bad years, but for that period, it certainly helped.
In the early stages of the season, form was indifferent, but manager Mickey Adams was gradually putting together a squad which was full of self-belief.
Away with a shot. And Charlie Oakway makes it 2-2.
A transitional stage for Mickey. I think at the end of the previous season, he got rid of sort of 10, 12 players. He still had players in the squad with any manager. When you come to a new club, he had players that were not particularly his style of players or his cup of tea. So it was always going to be a transitional step. But he made some good signings, I think, that year. You know, real characters.
That was a big thing for Mick, character. You know, obviously ability, but it was character, the main thing for him. Mickey had done it at other sides that he'd been to, like had a big clear out during the summer, and he was still kind of bringing players in that first season, and you could tell with the players that he was bringing in where he wanted to go.
Meanwhile, Freeman was making history again, netting the first Football League goal of the year 2000 against Exeter.
Phil said afterwards it couldn't have happened to anyone else, could it? So it was obvious.
Colkey used to call me Golden Balls, so you know, he used to take the mickey out of me and say it would always happen, them sort of things to me. But it's weird, really. I just had a funny feeling that I was going to score, and I remember writing a message on my t-shirt, Happy New Year. But obviously to actually end up getting the first goal of Millennium, you know, it's a massive thing. And again, you know, they're memories, and no one can take them away.
Good results were still hard to come by, though. Just 2 wins in 16 league games spanning November to February.
We had a dodgy patch when Mickey was under a little bit of pressure, but we got it together. The football evolved during the season, and we played a better style of football at the end of the season than we did at the start.
As that season went on, we started getting better and better and harder to beat. Then we signed a lanky centre-forward on loan.
You might recognise him, Robert Lester Zamora. a teenager no one knew much about.
He'd come from Bristol Rovers reserves as a young boy, and that first season coming in and getting some goals.
When Mickey signed him, I seem to remember I hadn't really seen much of him at all, and this rather sort of wiry youth turned up from Bristol Rovers. And Mickey thought, blimey, what have we got here?
Literally come down to the training ground, and I think one or two sessions, maybe, one session. And then the day after, it was a game, so thrown straight in, but, you know, managed to score on my debut, which settled the nerves, and rest is history, I suppose.
Well-chosen words. Zamora scored 6 in 6, including 3 goals in the astounding 7-1 victory at Chester.
All I'm thinking about is Charlie just saying it's the worst hat-trick he's ever seen. That's all I can remember, you know. I mean, it wasn't the greatest hat-trick. It was some dodgy goals, and I suppose the keeper didn't have the best day, but not for me, it was obviously over the moon. But, I mean, Charlie in the upper ear telling him it was the worst hat-trick he'd ever seen is probably one of the things that stick into my memory as well.
We were going into games confident that we would score. And when you've got that, you know, it makes a massive difference to the team.
In half a dozen matches, Bobby had galvanised the side. They finished the season with a 14-game unbeaten run and now couldn't wait for the next campaign to begin.
I think it just come a little bit too early for us at the end of the season, really.
It was all, hopefully, with a couple of more signings that next pre-season, all looking good for the year after.
I think there was a feeling amongst the players, you know, if we could get Bobby back, we had a real chance of falling season. We'd finished off okay the previous season. It was a period of time unbeaten, and you know, we thought as a group, if we could get that goal scorer, we'd have a chance.
Albion pursued Zamora all through the summer and managed to muster up £100,000 to finally land their man, the 19-year-old signing a 4-year contract. Another player also came in from Bristol Rovers on a free, and that was great business too, goalkeeper Michel Kuipers. Left-sided defender Nathan Jones was brought in from Southend United, while the second edition up front was Shrewsbury's bustling Scouse striker Lee Steele, intended as a foil for Zamora. The reshuffle wasn't an immediate success. The side suffered 3 league defeats out of 4 in the opening month. The only bright spot, a 2-1 home win over Rochdale.
I suppose it's one of those things that, you know, early start of the season, you don't always click, and, you know, I suppose the gaffer's been trying things and new formations and new players are joining. So it is sometimes a case of everybody gelling, and once you're there and everything's clicked, you'll roll on from there, and maybe that was the case.
At the end of August, Albion were languishing 20th in the early season standings, and the 2-0 home defeat to Kidderminster was cause for serious concern, not just in the stands, but the dressing room too.
There's always a pivotal point in the season. I think Mickey was under a little bit of pressure there. We were struggling for a little bit of form, and we just decided after the game, you know, we need to get together. We've been training. Sometimes you just need a breather, relax, get everyone away from the training ground and just sit down. Sometimes involves a couple of beers, and just get together and just iron a few things out amongst ourselves, which is great to be done away from the manager, to be honest. And that's what happened. And we keep talking about the characters in the team, but that's what sort of drove us for the next dozen games.
The team's heart-to-heart paid dividends. Torquay first to suffer as Albion hit them for 6, the launch pad for a special season.
We had the best team ethic in the league by a mile. We're probably arguably the fittest team I've ever seen.
There was no one that was above anybody else or you know, thought that he could sort of cut corners because he'd get pulled into line. And I feel that's where we set our standards from, you know, from on the training pitch.
We had like a really strong togetherness, and all these guys worked extremely hard to get results for the team.
All winners, all leaders. And you know, I've played in some of the good teams and stuff like that, but never to the extent the characters what were in that dressing room.
We had a great, great team spirit, and we had an outstanding goal scorer.
Freeman in towards the 6-yard box, and it's headed in by Bobby Zamora.
Soon the table looked much more appealing. Stringing victories together, the side rocketed up to 4th. Jones clinched the win at York, which had Mickey roaring his approval at the final whistle. But there was a shock in store for the manager. His popular right-hand man, Alan Cork, took a job at Cardiff just as Albion were building momentum.
It was always good cop, bad cop. You know, Mickey had little man syndrome and
running around all the time, and Corky was the mediator between the players, and he understood what the players wanted.
The poor geezer used to get bullied at times.
To be honest with you, we used to let him have it a bit, we used to beat him up, but you know, I think that he'd come in and it was a good cop and a bad cop, and you know, they were very good together. They really, you know, they knew how to get the best out of every person.
I remember once it'd been snowing. It's obviously very rare down here, but the session finished and he'd been giving a little bit of stick out, so the lads got hold of him and dragged him around the training ground, stripped him, but as we were dragging him around, his tooth came out, which we found absolutely unbelievably hilarious, and he's holding his tooth in his hand and he's going on, but the lads obviously thought it was great.
Some of the things he got us to do, just one sticks with my mind, Mickey sent us swimming. I think, I can't remember if it was after a game or a week where he didn't have a game. He sent us swimming into Brighton. Corky was to take us in the minibus. After a few antics at the swimming pool, with Malcolm getting pushed in, losing his glasses, Mickey was expecting us back to the training ground for about midday. I can't remember whether it was Darren or Chippy got Corky in a headlock in the van and said, take us to have a quick drink before we went back. So we stopped off in a pub, was told we was going to have one and then get back, because obviously Mickey was expecting us. I think it must have been an hour and a half later, we're still in there. And Corky was enjoying himself. Kind of lost track of time a bit, so when we got back, I think he had a bit of a rollicking for Mickey.
Cork's replacement was Bob Booker, a man cut from a similar mould. As we'd all see for ourselves later on, when the hard work was done, he was never short of a joke or two.
Bob was a lively character as well. You know, I think Mickey wouldn't have wanted anything else. I mean, he'd lost one lively character, he wanted someone with similar traits to replace him. And Bob, again, was a great bloke.
Been with Mickey at Brentford, and then he left suddenly and obviously came to Brighton and said, listen, if I ever get the chance, I'll come for you, which he did. So it was completely out of the blue. Got a call on a Wednesday, and then I think we played away at Hull on the Friday night, and that was my debut, really.
It was also Albion's fifth successive league win, amid an unbeaten run which yielded 23 points from a possible 27. A fortnight later, the big one, a trip to Leaders Chesterfield.
The Chesterfield game was quite a high-pressure game, because they were one of our competitors, and especially away from home.
Did Charlie get sent off as well?
We played really well as a team that day, but unfortunately we did lose 1-0. But I think it gave everybody so much confidence.
I remember them really celebrating after the game. It's one thing we certainly remembered as the season wore on. I don't think you forget things like that.
Spurred on by that bitter defeat, the players simply redoubled their efforts. They lost just four league games from mid-October to the start of March, taking maximum points from 12 of the 18 matches. By the new year, they were firmly established in second spot, as opponents struggled to find an answer to one particularly potent partnership, defender Paul Watson supplying countless goals for Zamora.
Came one day on the training pitch, really, Mickey and I think it was Corky. And Corky kind of said, why don't just like put the ball down, Bobby, you run away, like you're not interested. Just kind of make a bit of eye contact when he turns, and I just stick it into an area, and hopefully Bobby will get on the end of it. And it worked so many times, it was unbelievable.
The free kicks and corners that Wise had put in, and for Bobby, you know, they were like telepathic, really.
Probably to date, you know, probably the best sort of partnership. His delivery was he's probably up there, you know, with the best. You know, I've been lucky enough to play for a lot of good players, and yeah, to be honest, his left foot is. He's special.
It's brilliant for me. It's a shame he couldn't take me to Tottenham, but there we go, never mind.
Chesterfield were still top, but there was no doubt which club boasted the division's most outstanding player.
We had a duel in the end. We had a goal scorer, which got us success. I think the rest of the group we're ready to do the work, and we had the missing ingredient.
You know, with a little of a gem up front in Bobby, who was, you know, could score goals for fun, to be fair. And when you've got someone that's scoring the goals for you, you know, the players that we had, you know, up the spine of the team and out, what, you know, it complemented it all.
We loved it because he gave us our win bonus every week, so we were more than happy to have him with us.
The boys loved him. Now he's never changed. Now he's gone on, you know, to what he's achieved, England national, he hasn't changed.
We knew some days he'd be in the paper and he'd get a bit cocky and he'd be strutting around with Nathan, and Charlie would go, right, we'll smash him today, you know, just to bring him down to earth.
The lads there were, every single one of them was superb, and it was an absolute pleasure. Still the best times of my career, you know, down there and going into training and having a laugh and a joke with all those guys.
Zamora's stunning form made it easy for outsiders to label Albion a one-man team. They were wide of the mark. The lineup was strong throughout, especially the heart of the side, with Danny Cullip and Charlie Oakway, a formidable duo, marshalling affairs both on and off the field.
Charlie and Danny were the vocal, mouthy, hard, the Mitchell brothers, we used to call them.
Danny, nicest fellow you'll meet off the pitch, but absolute nightmare.
Charlie don't take no prisoners. He's an absolute nightmare and he don't care what he says.
Charlie and Danny have got all the old tricks on the pitch and it's horrible playing against them and it can knock you off your game. And I remember saying it when I first signed for Brighton, I was much more happier that they were in the same changing room as me now.
Yeah, we had some great games against them. I remember even in the cup games, Danny Cullif was there marking me all the time, trying to bite my ear and pinch my bum and do it all sorts, Danny. But yeah, we had some great times against them.
There was a moment when all the players started shaving their hair off, which I think really kind of engendered a kind of, come on then, you know, we were all in this together. Every week, one more of the players had hacked all their hair off, and you could tell they were a team.
Even later on, when Steve Cobble come in, I remember him saying, like, and Charlie will vouch for this, he said, I can leave the change of training ground and not have to worry about any problems because they manage themselves.
Just occasionally, though, Adams had to crack the whip. Albion were outplaying most opponents, but slipped up on a midweek trip to Scunthorpe and incurred the manager's wrath.
Scunthorpe had 5-6 players missing, had a really young team out, and Paul Brooker scored early.
I thought we played all right at Scunthorpe. We did all right first half. Unfortunate, didn't really get going second half.
They scored twice.
Mickey went absolutely mental.
Mickey had a few choice words to say after the game. The coach broke down on the way back down the M1.
We got back to Brighton around 1:30 in the morning. As we're getting off the coach, he said 8:30 in the morning.
9 o'clock, we were round the pond and 45 laps of pond with Mickey on a bike and a whistle. I think he's only bar one or two didn't want to throw him in the pond.
And at the end of that, he said, well, there's your time. You did all right first half. Second half was rubbish, so that was the 45 minutes you owed me. All the supporters had to go to work, so you had to go to work. So we sort of got together after that, went on an amazing run, smashed hull on the Saturday.
That 3-0 win set the tone for the run-in. Albion didn't lose again until the final day, and the 4 wins and 2 draws that followed the Scunthorpe debacle meant that by mid-April, automatic promotion could be clinched away at Plymouth, as long as results elsewhere were favourable.
There was so many factors for us to get promoted that day. Teams needed to lose all over the place.
Bizarre day because, you know, it's one of those results that you're looking on everybody what they were going to do, and, you know, people in the tunnel were sort of sliding the we're going up flags into the dugout and so-and-so scoring, you're looking at the watch.
It'll fall though. Oh, it's a dramatic start and Paul Brooker has given Brighton the lead.
We knew that we had to take care of our own business. And we were under pressure to perform and get a result.
Just opened up for Gary Hart here. He's going to fall for Zamora. This is dangerous. And there's the second goal for Brighton.
And all of a sudden the call come through from the tunnel that, you know, everything had fallen into place. And then it was celebration time.
There goes the full-time whistle. Brighton are promoted back to Division 2. Results have gone their way.
Brilliant. absolutely brilliant. I'd not been promoted for.
It was fantastic to see everybody so happy, and I think we deserved, everything that we got that day.
Promotion achieved with 6 games to spare. Now the target was the title. Chesterfield were losing their grip. The club's dodgy financial dealings would be punished with a 9-point deduction come May. By then, they'd been overtaken anyway and suffered the ultimate indignity, losing at Withdean to hand Albion the trophy.
The Chesterfield night, sticks vividly in my memory. Evening games always did down there.
Tuesday night at Withdean, and you're coming out and you're seeing these envelopes and money being handed around.
All the fans had the brown envelopes and paper bag, all that sort of stuff. It was brilliant. It just added to the atmosphere.
Completely dominated the game as well. I don't think they even had a shot.
It was basically a battle to see who was going to be winning that league and who was the ultimate daddy. And they turned up and we beat them 1-0.
And that goal at the end, although it was an own goal, Danny's still claiming it, I think.
It just hit me on the head, to be fair. It was a good delivery.
We won it fairly. We overhauled Chesterfield in that run-in.
It was fantastic that we didn't need the deduction to actually beat them.
Sweet revenge for October's defeat.
Some of the people we've mentioned before, the characters, Nathan Jones and people like that, kind of let Chesterfield know that we'd won, and that we'd won won the league. So it was about 10 or 15 minutes there before we come back out and actually lifted the trophy. That there's a few antics going on, but I'll leave that for another day.
A fantastic evening, and drinking champagne in Buddy's at 3 o'clock in the morning with bacon and eggs was quite a great time for all of us.
It's a wonderful feeling to be, the head of a club when you win something and join in with the fans, and there I was on the pitch taking in all the glory, of course.
It was a great season, and Zamora scoring bucket loads of goals. He was real class even then.
The first championship at Withdean was just brilliant. I mean, we hadn't tasted any success for a long, long time. And it was the group of players that Mickey Adams brought together which got us that championship.
It was really, really a great honour to represent the club and to see all the supporters at the end coming out and celebrate with us was marvellous.
Thousands took to the streets as the club paraded its first silverware for 36 years. Very few would have guessed they'd be doing this all over again just 12 months later. Incredible success for Mickey Adams' men, but through the years, quite a few different bosses would plan their strategies here in the manager's office at Withdean, including one who was a Palace legend.
In many ways, you think, well, I can't lose because it's got to get better. Even just by continuation, it would have got better. But I felt as if I could do something.
More from him later. But first, let's see how Albion's remarkable rise continued. There were just a handful of signings to boost the squad for life in the third tier, including fullback Robbie Pethick, who arrived on a free from Bristol Rovers. German target man Dirk Lehmann swapped Hibernian for life much further south. And another player Mickey Adams knew from his time at Fulham slotted into the heart of a defence, 34-year-old Simon Morgan.
We'd go off running, there'd be Morgs sat on the bench with his knee, with a bit of ice, reading the sun. And we're thinking, oh, what's this idea?
Training was not my strong point, to be honest with you. Didn't like training, would avoid it, try any excuse. It's like the kid in the homework, try any excuse to get out of it.
Sam Morgan come in, Al Fayed's best mate, and it was just different gear. Absolutely different gear. Just slotted in, old timer, never trained, and he played, he was superb.
He was just immense. He was the ball magnet. He would never mark anyone and just stand in the right position in the 6-yard box and just clear things, talk to Danny, Mr. Angry and Mr. Cool. He was just a fantastic guy to have about.
Morgan's seamless transition after 11 years at Craven Cottage helped the side get off to an excellent start, averaging over 2 points a game throughout the first month to sit sixth. In the players' minds, there was already the prospect of another promotion challenge.
We had that confidence going into it from the previous year, and the year before that, if you like, really. The groundwork had been done and the group of players were literally, the nucleus was still there. And confidence is a massive, massive part of football. It's huge. And we was confident. We didn't fear anybody.
We had a confidence in the group and it comes back to Bobby again, but confidence that Bobby could score goals at this level.
Steele with a good ball into Brooker, ball on the pop, push the ball, a free header! Brighton Hove Albion take the lead, and Bobby Zamora makes Ian Holloway pay!
We wouldn't shout it publicly, but there was a belief that we could do well in the next division up.
Coming into the dressing room for the first time as an outsider, if you like, and just seeing the strength of character in the room. There's no fear in there whatsoever. Didn't like tasting defeat, they wanted to win. And then you started playing the first few games, and it wasn't just the strength of character that came through, but it was actually the ability of the team, of the players. And then you had someone who could put the ball in the net. I don't think it was very long into the season when everyone realised we've got a chance here.
Now back to Jones. Jones hits it in. In comes Ward. Not the best punch. And waits on the far post. White do steal it. Right in the end.
Paul Watson's late winner against Stoke, with Albion now top. And the defender scored again as the club celebrated its centenary against Bournemouth.
And it's in! Everybody missed it. And Paul Watson claims the goal for Brighton Hove Albion.
And a memorable day like that, to obviously get your name on the score sheet. It's brilliant.
Eddie Howe's own goal meant the 100th anniversary was marked with a 2-1 win. But just as everything seemed to be going Albion's way, Mickey Adams dropped a bombshell. He was leaving to become an assistant manager in the Premiership.
I was approached by Leicester to, you know, for Mickey to go there, and I would always allow, you know, managers or players to talk to other clubs if it was in the right moment in their careers and so on.
It was no secret that Mickey was being touted around for a number of jobs. You know, we did say, leave it to us, Mickey, we'll make you a millionaire. But we were obviously sad to see him go.
It wasn't so much a surprise, obviously, because he was doing well, right, and a lot of clubs were probably wanting his services, but for him to actually leave what we had here, it was disappointing. But everyone kind of wished Mickey all the best. He's obviously done his work in the lower leagues and deserved his chance at a higher level.
I was happy for him to go. He went with my best wishes. My job was to make sure we had another very good manager in his place very quickly. And I think Peter did an excellent job coming in and taking over the reins.
Ironically, Peter Taylor was the manager Leicester had just sacked. These would be very different surroundings for a man whose recent experience included making David Beckham the England captain only a year earlier.
It was a good opportunity because, of course, you know, I was quite down losing my Leicester job, and then all of a sudden you get the opportunity to take over Brighton, and who are doing exceptionally well in the division, and you think, well, you know, it's a good opportunity, and you know, and as a young player, I used to play against Brighton, and I just knew the history of the club.
Taylor had done his time in the lower leagues, but nothing could prepare him for what he saw at his first training session as the squad got themselves in the mood to face Oldham.
We trained like we normally trained on a Friday. You know, Danny would be kicking somebody and Charlie would be threatening someone else.
People flying around, smashing each other, people limping off and just getting on with it and stuff like that.
The amount of times my own players tried to smash me, and they used to play kick the nerd with me and Paul Brooker.
And he had to stop training. Peter Taylor said, what are you doing?
He said, whoa, you know, what the hell's going on here?
And the whistle came out and a couple of players were on a heap in the floor, and Peter Taylor's sort of blowing his top saying, we've got a game tomorrow. And it's just like deathly silence, and players thinking, well, that's what we do.
I saw players kicking lumps out of each other, and the most horrendous tackles I've ever seen.
We were used to that. You know, we'd all been together as a group for 18 months. That's how we did things, and he just let it run. We just ran with it, to be honest.
Chip in a flag, hands go up for offside. It's not offside. The block is from Rogers, and it's turned in. Brighton make the perfect start to life under Peter Taylor. A comprehensive 3-0 success meant the boss knew he'd made a good choice. It was immediately obvious there'd be no need for wholesale changes. Taylor's task was primarily to keep the ball rolling.
I've been quite fortunate to have plenty of jobs, and I've took over a lot of jobs where you've taken over from a good manager. So you have to be very, very careful. Now, Mickey was a very popular and good manager at Brighton. So the last thing you do is go in there and change everything, because he's no good and the team are no good. So you basically try to keep it going, and thankfully that's what we've done.
Then towards the near post, Tullock looks for the flick on, gets it. Zamora is penetrating the far post, and Zamora glances the header down, and Brighton complete their comeback here at Miller Lane.
You think, first and foremost, losing your manager would be a massive blow, as results and performances were shown in other leagues. When the manager goes at any stage of the season, if if they're doing well and the manager's been poached and he's had to go. But there again, it was down to a group of players that were determined, and Peter Taylor must have felt that and thought, I've got a group here and it's, you know, business as usual.
He dabbled with a few formations at times and bits and pieces, but on a whole, everybody, you know, still had that understanding of what each other wants.
Added one or two new things in, varied the training a little bit. Gave me lots more days off, which was perfect.
Didn't make many changes straight away. You know, we were going well. We were going towards the top of the league, and you know, made a couple of signings. But he just kept the momentum going, to be honest.
By February, 3.5 months into Taylor's tenure, Albion was second and about to face the leaders Reading off the back of a surprise defeat at Oldham. Midfielder Junior Lewis made his home debut.
I think we changed the shape a little bit. We put some real athletes in the middle of the park, so it might have meant that Charlie or Paul Rogers got left out, I don't know, but which would have been big decisions. And I think I might have said to the team before that game, you know, I've had to leave out some real characters for this one. I've had to leave out some really good players that I'm not proud about doing, but it was an honest decision.
Thoroughly battered them, I think. I think you're 3-1, wasn't it, in the score? Absolutely battered them, played them off the park, and as I say, great performance and great win.
We were on a real good run, really, really good run for Reading at that point, and we were just blown out of the water that night.
I remember the key game at the with Dean on it, I think it was a Tuesday night, cold, wet Tuesday night, and we got beaten up a little bit.
Demora's made a run through, can he apply the perfect finish? He takes it round Ben Roberts, he's been forced very wide. Demora lays it back across the goal, and Junior Lewis!
And that was the night where I thought, yeah, we can do it here.
Not only did we bounced back with a bit of style, we bounced back against the leaders at that particular time, and I think we made a little bit of a statement that night that you know, we can kick on, and I'm sure it made Reading a little bit nervous.
Albion kept up the pressure on Alan Pardew's team, and when they made the reverse trip to Reading's Madejski Stadium a month later, they were 5 points behind their opponents with a game in hand. A key day in the title race. Carpenter, he can hit them from distance. Terrific shot.
We had a rivalry with Reading, to be fair. We had quite a big rivalry.
Watson with it. By the skin of their teeth, the Royals clung on to a goalless draw, Albion still very much in the title hunt. But against Notts County, a gigantic setback. A nasty shoulder injury for Zamora meant over Easter they'd have to prove they could finish off opponents even without their star striker.
Everybody was thinking, well, you know, we're close to promotion now. Are you going to fall short? You haven't got Bobby Zamora, how are you going to score goals? And I think we were 3-0 up after about 20 minutes.
Of course, we were without Bobby, and then you think, blimey, you know, I'm praising him so much, and you've got your natural goal scorer. And I think against Colchester, we might have even played Danny Webb and Wayne Gray up front.
Bobby was such a wonderful player. Obviously, we knew we would miss him, so it was up to us to sort of step up to the plate and try and, you know, keep what we had going, you know, to keep it going.
The fans were singing 3-0 to the one-man team.
Yeah, that weekend was massive for us. So to beat Colchester 4-1 away from home was a great result. And then Bristol City at home was the season-defying game.
Lewis gave Albion the start they wanted, with a faint touch from one of those familiar, dangerous free kicks. But Bristol City were chasing a playoff place themselves, and Kuipers was overworked.
What an incredible, incredible game that was.
Michelle was pulling saves out the top corner, the bottom corner.
Eventually, Tom Doherty levelled the scores. In Zamora's absence, Albion needed a new hero.
Brighton 1, Bristol City 1. It's been hard work. Hart with the ball in. Goal! Brighton have done it! Right at the end, makes the lead, Steele!
Must have been about 5 yards offside.
Steele scored in the last minute with a goal that was, you know, about 5 yards offside at least.
You could hear the relief in the crowd. Half of them were on the way out, you know, and then that was it again, mayhem.
And that was virtually it then. The celebrations after, I think, were although we weren't officially promoted, I think everyone knew that was the moment we were up. Just fantastic weekend.
The substitute's dramatic late contribution meant with Zamora back at Peterborough, Albion could all but complete the job. But Bobby had a poor penalty saved, and Gary Hart suffered a sickening injury as the afternoon threatened to turn sour.
It was 0-0 when I broke my leg early doors, but I knew we'd win it anyway. No problem, didn't need me out there.
Hart was right. You could never keep Zamora quiet for long, and thousands of travelling fans went balmy as Bobby's winner put Albion on the brink. When Reading drew at Tranmere 24 hours later, a second successive promotion was in the bag.
We really knew with that result that was it, even though it wasn't confirmed 100% until the next day when I remember I was at home and we was all, you know, listening to radios. It was probably the longest 90 minutes we were all listening to.
Just a surreal feeling watching teletext until that full time came up that Reading hadn't won and we were promoted.
I was in my apartment in Hayward Heath with Steve Melton, and with us being a pair of idiots, I think I was about 26, Steve must have only been 22. I had a few bottles of champagne in the kitchen, so we decided to go out and spray each other in the street.
Reading's title challenge was destroyed by 9 draws in their last 10 games, as Albion racked up 7 victories. They've been beaten just 4 times since Taylor took charge, and a goalless draw against Swindon had the champagne corks popping again. A point enough to bring another trophy to the South Coast. Incredible.
We done it in style in the end, and you know, to only lose 4 matches was brilliant. But we played some good stuff, and I think that we slightly improved as a football team. We carried on entertaining supporters and got a nice present at the end of it.
Reward for a long, hard season, and very gratifying, and just the end of a fantastic year that I had.
Promotions are good enough, but to win back-to-back championships is an unbelievable feeling.
The first one, after waiting so long, was a massive thing for the fans. To win the other one, it doesn't happen very often, but he just got in the habit again. I didn't play personally as many games in the second one as the first season, but still really proud of the achievement of winning back-to-back championships.
So it was all aboard the bus for another city-wide celebration of success against the odds.
It's a fun day out for everyone, I think, and as I say, you know, to do it 2 years on the bounce was lovely.
They're fantastic days for the whole family, actually. You know, you're away from your family a lot during the season, and then actually we brought them all on the bus, and the kids and everything else like that. So no, it was great, and they come out and the fans come out in their droves, you know, to support us, which was fantastic.
It was a nice day, and it was a bit blowy, but I think the sun was out, which was quite nice. And I remember the boys kept looking at the top windows of all the buildings that we were going past, asking for some thrills from some of the young ladies, but I'm not too sure they got some.
The boisterous atmosphere on the bus was matched as the fans congregated in Hove to be treated to a very special performance.
Well, he's always likely to pop up now and again, he long live Freddie, that's what I say, you know. It was an idea of mine that we was out with the chairman one night, and I pulled Dick, bless him, and said, Dick, I've got a bit of an idea, I want to run it across you. I don't just want to make myself look an idiot, which I'm sure I did to some people. But he just said, Bob, I love it. That is so bright. Got a few cobwebs on it. A few people might remember this. It's Freddie's microphone, which made an appearance on that day. And, you know, that'll live me forever. You know, that hangs up in the garage. And every time I look at it, I have a bit of a giggle at myself. And I'm sure people have a bit of a giggle at myself. But you know, that was something that had to be done, and that I ran across the chairman, and I think it went down okay.
Surprisingly, Taylor took a bow too, deciding to leave a few days later. Without a proper home, the club was finding it hard to hang on to its prize assets.
When I left Brighton, of course, I was always a little bit disappointed that I didn't want fans to think that I'd let them down. I didn't want them to think that I was going to go to, you know, I had another job lined up, which wasn't the case. There was just a little, maybe a bit of a disagreement between when the new stadium was going to be ready and what I was told at my interview. And so I'm not sure that was the right decision by me. We all move on, and thankfully, you know, I eventually get the whole job, and I'm back in work again.
Time flies. More than 5 years have passed since the last game at the Goldstone, and getting everyone on board with the proposals for a new ground was a painstaking process. A 61,000 signature petition in favour of Falmer was handed to Brighton and Hove City Council, who went along with the mood of the majority. Soon after, the Council's planning committee gave the green light to Albion's application for a state-of-the-art stadium.
It was 11 votes to 1, I believe, if I remember rightly.
You needed to have the club and the council in the same place. You needed to have them as co-advocates for the cause, and you needed to give certainty to the process.
We were underway. Then, of course, the government stepped in and called for a public inquiry, and the saga was to rumble on quite a few years yet.
Back-to-back promotions would be a hard act to follow, but Albion thought they had the ideal candidate already on the staff. Former assistant manager and the then director of youth, Martin Hinshelwood.
If you get the opportunity, you're always going to take it, aren't you? In hindsight, which is easy, you probably would have said, well, the next job was the one to get. But when you get the opportunity, you relish the challenge.
I'm a great believer in promoting from within, and Martin deserved his chance.
Hampered by its humble surroundings, the club would have to punch above its weight. At least Albion managed to stave off interest in Bobby Zamora, while Paul Kitson and Guy Butters added some experience to the squad by the end of August. But it was a callow side which began the season, with youngsters like Adam Hinshelwood, Sean Wilkinson and Dan Marnie all getting their chance to make an impression in Martin Hinshelwood's team.
And I can remember his first game. I think they went up to Burnley, won 3-1, and everyone, man, this is great, this is easy.
You know, we didn't get the job till fairly late in pre-season, so it was always difficult trying to get players in. But I think you look at the Burnley game and you look at it, and there's one player that started, played in that level before.
Now Oakway picks it up, back with Hart in midfield again. Oakway stabbing the ball forward, it'll find Zamora. It's a great run inside from Melton. Zamora's found him, chance for Steve Melton, goal for Brighton and Hove Albion. Here at Turf Moor, they lead by a goal to nil.
We played some great stuff in that game and put in a great performance.
Quickly worked up to Taylor on halfway. Taylor tries to toe and turn, and Hinshelwood dives in and wins the ball, a sign of his growing confidence. It comes to Brooker. Brooker heading away on the left-hand side. Will he go for goal on his own? Brooker striding forward and finishing with fantastic confidence to make it 2-0. Good possession football from Brighton this. Now Watson tries for a curler. It's blocked by the Coppers, and it'll run for Zamora to stab in. It's 3. I'm not sure I believe this. Zamora just turns and pumps his fist at those ecstatic Brighton and Hove Albion fans.
Spirits were high, and a goalless draw at home to Coventry in the next match suggested the season might not be as tough as everyone feared. But at the end of the first week, an innocuous-looking challenge in the Norwich match saw Zamora limp off with a damaged knee.
Gutted to pick up an injury. I think I was, might have missed 6 games or something like that.
Bobby records spoke for itself at the lower level. And with the players we had, virtually we had to play sort of a 4-3-3 with him being the central man that could hold it up and bring other players in. And he did that great, and he's gone on to do that ever since. And when you lose something like that, then it's a big miss, and I'm not blaming him, but I am.
Without its pivotal striker, the side was pitched into a losing run that would eventually stretch to a record 12 league matches. The inexperienced Division 1 new boys were providing easy pickings for their opponents, and Hinshelwood's dream job was turning into a nightmare.
I thought we were very unlucky, obviously given the job very late in pre-season and not perhaps the amount of time that he needed to assemble the side that he wanted to. Remember, there's a lot of first-year pros making their debuts, going to difficult places as well. It's difficult enough going to these places when you've got a full side, but when you've got half the side out injured.
At the end of September, Bobby was back and underlined how much he'd been missed with a goal against Grimsby. Not enough, though, to prevent another league defeat. And the 10th in a row away at Watford ended Hinshelwood's reign.
I can remember it was only yesterday, and a shot from 30 yards. 9 times out of 10, Michelle would save, and it popped back out and they scored. There were quite a few young boys playing as well. So you felt we lost 1-0 again, but the potential and the way we played was first class. But Monday morning comes around, and that's history now. But as I say, those games, even though we lost the games, the players were first class, and I couldn't have asked for any more.
It was a tough time for someone who's got the club at heart to go through what he went through, and we all went through. You know, it was very difficult being a the club so long that he had been with. So very difficult times, but you stick by the manager who's everything in charge until decisions are made, and that's what we had to do. So I think that was a very difficult time for the club, and particularly for Martin Hinshelwood.
You know, in a sense, it would have been easier for Martin if we hadn't been going into the Championship, as opposed to if we'd been going into one of the lower leagues. Therefore, the pressure was on from day one, and it is unfortunate that it didn't work out, but I wasn't about to sack Martin from the club completely. It was not fair, wouldn't have been fair to do that. I offered him his job back as director of youth football, and I'm glad to say that he's still at the club today.
He's a good guy, Martin. He's been a great servant for the club in different capacities, you know, assistant manager now on the youth side of things. So perhaps too nice a man to be a manager.
I had to get a more experienced manager in quickly, and that's when I went and moved for Steve Coppell.
Now this was a turn up for the books. Coppell was a long-standing Crystal Palace hero, but his managerial pedigree couldn't be ignored.
I think when I took over, from memory, I think the team had 4 points from 11 games or something like that. And, you know, in many ways you think, well, I can't lose because it's got to get better. You know, even just by continuation it would have got better. But I felt as if I could do something, and I went in, and I think my first game was a home game against Sheffield United.
The back of the shorter figure of Anatole comes to Barrett, he helps him to take up, and there! And Brighton have scored! Does find Zamora, left side of the box, trying to get the crossing towards Barrett, Barrett's there! He outjumps the taller page! There, Barrett gets his first goal for Brighton!
You were, I think, 2-0 up at one stage, and I thought, well, this is going to be easy. And then we ended up losing the game 4-2. In reality, I never felt comfortable even at 2-0 up. I thought, you know, Sheffield are going to bite us here. And they did, and they bit us hard. And that was the frailty, I think, of the team. We never really controlled games. We fought like tigers all season.
I got on really well with Steve. Found him actually quite fascinating because he wasn't your sort of average manager. He was a very intelligent man, very helpful, very open. And also, the thing that people missed about him, sort of seen as a bit of a dour character, but had a very dry sense of humour, which we saw well remembering his very first game at Withdean, Sheffield United, and the famous Phil Prosser referee, supposedly denying Brighton all sorts of things, and Ivor Kaplan, who was the MP for Hove at the time, coming up straight after the game, urging the FA to do this, that and the other to Phil Prosser, hung, draw and quarter him. And this was relayed to Steve, and I can just remember he had a little chuckle and said, what about world peace?
While Coppell was still getting used to his new surroundings, his first away game was on very familiar territory. Selhurst Park offered a daunting test for a team in transition.
It was still very much a testing period for me. I was looking at the team and I knew it wasn't right, but whatever you do on the training field, you never can really prove a theory. You have to prove the theory in match play, in the real thing. And I was sort of toying with shapes and ideas and permutations within the team. And I think the Palace game was still very much at that level. I knew what we had wasn't right, the mix wasn't right. But I had to sort of prove it to go in another direction. I would have loved us to have gone there and won 3-0, don't get me wrong. But it proved to be a very difficult night all round.
Very true. Albion fans have never heard the end of the 5-0 defeat. And in truth, it could have been even worse.
He made a double substitution. Charlie and Chippy came off and me and Simon Roger went on. And it was like you say, it's 5-0 down. And he said to me, don't let it get out of hand. So after the horse has bolted a little bit, but we kept it to 5-0, so job done.
I suppose that was rock bottom as far as the team went that season, to lose that game to the bitter rivals, looking up from the bottom of the table. From there onwards, it could only get better.
With new signings Simon Roger and Dean Blackwell settling in, Albion were in the mood to make a fresh start. A week after the trouncing at Palace, Bradford City were beaten.
That was very important. You know, it gave the players, well, you know, a reason. They must have thought, well, you know, he does know something about what he's talking about. You know, again, for the fans, because then, of course, the dressing rooms were at the other end of that they have been the last couple of seasons, and they had to walk all the way round the back of the far side in front of the home supporters. You're doing that as an ex-Palace man when you haven't won a game. It's totally different from being an ex-Palace man who has won a game. And, you know, it's softened a few attitudes towards me, I think.
That first league win for 3 months was evidence of a transformation that had taken place behind the scenes.
He was the best manager I've ever had. Realistically, he was fantastic.
When you've got a smaller group of players, a smaller budget to the teams, you've got to make sure that you are prepared. And the preparation was, you know, it was first-class preparation. You know exactly how the team played, you know exactly their shape, how the opposition individually played.
Steve was, he was brilliant, a real good manager, man management, organisation, professionalism. It was a real good vibe around the club.
Quiet, I think, you know, you could see him always thinking, taking everything in, but no, a very good manager and done a great job for us.
People talk about motivation. The motivation comes from within the dressing room. It doesn't matter, you know, I could be General Patton in the dressing room, thumping tables and pushing people on, but if the players don't want to do it, or they don't feel they're good enough to do it, then it's never going to happen. The players in that dressing room, you know, they were driven. You know, that mentality was very much to the fore. They didn't want to be where they were. They wanted to prove that they were capable of playing at the level, and even higher if necessary.
The opportunity to showcase the improvements came in the next match away at Molineux, in front of the Sky Sports cameras. Very different to with Dean, and an occasion to relish.
Every time I think about that particular game, I always get filled with emotion because it was such a special night.
Oh, and Zamora is in, and Brighton are in front. It's Bobby Zamora.
It was probably, you know, one of the biggest stages that I'd sort of played in. Going to Molineux and being able to score a goal like that was special.
Murray thinks he's got a chance. Not a chance. In it goes.
Actually, after the game, we had to meet up with the under-21s and Matty Murray was in goal. And it was obviously with the 21s, so it's nice. Jolyon Lescott, I think, was there as well. So it was nice to go and see them guys and just give them a little bit of banter as well. So, no, another special goal.
Something opens up. Right for him, and it's deflected. Ooh, just past the post, and that is a let-off.
We played really well as a team. We scored a fantastic goal, and we were all individually playing on top of our game.
Inworthy centre. Oh, it came all the way through to Alex Ray. Fine save, and an even better one to deny the follow-up from Cooper.
I remember the shot coming in from Alex Ray, and I went sharp down to my left, came out to Kenny Miller, so I got up, saved it with my top hand, and the ball went perfectly up in the air and dropped straight down in my arms, and I just remember looking up, and players looked at me in disbelief.
We needed our back five to be at the top of the game. For us to have any chance of getting out of the situation we were in, the back five or back six, as it eventually turned into with the three centre-backs we played, you know, the back six had to be at the top of the game an awful lot of the time. And when your goalkeeper's right, he exudes a confidence that is infectious. And, you know, Michel lived on making saves.
Kuipers wasn't quite unbeatable. In the end, Wolves' pressure did pay off, and Kenny Miller earned them a draw. But the boss had seen plenty of positives.
To go there at any stage, even now, and get a point, is, you know, you would say that's a good point.
Koppel had another ace up his sleeve. Arsenal youngster Steve Sibwell joined on loan, and after a debut win against Derby, led a fight back from two down at Preston.
The sliding shot comes in, and it's a goal. And Brighton are well and truly back in this one. The outcome by no means sorted, Andy.
Well, no, not while that man's around.
And here comes the equaliser. 2-2. Well, Brighton and Hove Albion were dead and buried at half time.
Well, Stephen Sidwell, I've probably known from about 11 years of age. He was a winner from that early age. He had a sort of bearing about him. You know, he's aggressive, he could play, he could score goals. Great engine. And again, he had that drive in the dressing room. He matched the energy levels of Danny, Charlie, you know, or Chippy, all the key players within that team. Bobby, you know, he fell in as if he'd been there an awful long time. All of a sudden, you could see a solid shape developing with the three centre-backs, goalkeeper, midfield, and you know, with Bobby at the sharp end, then you always knew there were goals there or thereabouts.
Sidwell had put himself in the shop window, and after January's unlucky goalless draw at Coventry, Reading reached for the chequebook. So back to the drawing board for Albion, the one-all home draw with league leaders Portsmouth proving they still had the belief to survive, even though the team had been in the bottom three since early September. What Albion didn't need now was a goalkeeping crisis, but with Michel Kuipers injured and Ben Roberts ill, 43-year-old Dave Besant was pressed into action between the posts, away at fellow strugglers Walsall. The veteran had no chance with the Saddler's goal, and even Bobby couldn't find a way to save the game. With exactly 3 months of the season remaining after the next defeat at home to Wimbledon, Albion were 5 points adrift of safety. But three successive wins in February lifted the team off the foot of the table. Nobody saw the first one coming, as Wolves were savaged at Withdean.
You look at certain games, it's amazing. Before the game, you were thinking, oh, you know, we'll do well to get points in this match. And sometimes things just click.
Obviously, I enjoyed my goal as well, because I absolutely hustled, bustled about three of them off the ball, went round the keeper, and that's unlike me. I'd go around and bang it over the bar or something.
To beat the likes of Wolves 4-1, you've got Paul Ince and, you know, them playing from, you know, people you'd watched in your lifetime of football, you know, a legend, and he's getting bullied by Charlie and Chippy, and, you know, it's quite good. I don't think he would have enjoyed it.
Albion looked to Wolves too for the loan signing of defender Ivar Ingemarsson and continued their upturn away at Bradford.
Jorgensen will cross, here's a header, brilliantly kept out, Ashley Ward inside the 6-yard area. Gary Hart might have got the better of Atherton here, the cross is deep, it's Zamora's header, off the post. In fact, he's given the goal. He has given the goal. It's the referee's assistant who flagged there. I thought he had done. Bobby Zamora's header has squeezed over the line in the opinion of the referee's assistant.
Off the pitch, an even more important battle got underway. The public inquiry into the proposed new stadium.
It became apparent to me that the club had put fantastic amount of work into the whole project. They had experts on noise, lighting, every sort of environmental aspect of the development. Of course, there was quite a lot of opposition, as we know, from Falmer Parish Council, Lewes District Council. The most impressive speaker was Martin Perry, who was absolutely on top of his brief, and he was in the witness box for 2, if not 3 days, and to stand up to that level of interrogation was extremely impressive.
Meanwhile, Albion increased their attacking options as Anthony Rougier joined on loan from Reading. He made his mark instantly against Millwall, lifting the club clear of the bottom three for the first time since Coppell's arrival.
I think with forwards, you always got to have something different. And he never realised his potential at Reading. So when I knew he was available, I thought, well, he's never going to play every game at the top of his game, but he can be significant.
And he was. After a couple of setbacks on the road, Rougier's antics helped Albion record back-to-back home wins over Rotherham and Nottingham Forest to keep them above the relegation zone. The mood in the camp was good. The squad celebrating Besant's 44th birthday with a nice slice of cake and a good old sing-song.
Happy birthday, Big Five! Happy birthday to you!
At least the players had hit the right notes on the pitch, still in with a chance of survival. Another precious point was earned with a 2-2 draw at Ipswich.
We've got a couple in the box, Rougier and Brooker. It's Rougier, off the crossbar and in! It may well have gone in off Marshall. Here's Brooker against Naylor, and he's got the better of him. Still Brooker, and Rouget must be 2-1 Brighton.
He didn't know what he was doing. We didn't know what he was doing, but he felt he could do something different. And again, he wanted to prove a point. He wanted to prove that he was capable of playing right at the very top.
The end of March gave the side the chance to avenge its humiliation at Selhurst Park. Albion were a whisker from beating Palace, but had to settle for a 0-0 before heading off to Reading for another TV game.
He's trying to weave his way through, but he's a Moran. He plays a back pass, and it's going to be given, you know.
Yeah, he's right. Referee's right. Bobby Zamora wasn't even expecting that, but well done the referee. Good spot.
Well, it's been taken quickly, and Brooker has put it in, and they're going to get away with that.
Well, that goal was great because it was down. Take it quick rather than just have an organised set piece routine. Hit the down, bump, play, goal.
Just put it down and played it to Bozzy to stick it away. So an important 3 points for us there as well.
Free kick.
Came in and he sort of glossed over the surface. He never took on the real mentality of the dressing room, I would say.
It is all over. It is a vital victory for Steve Coppell's Brighton, who really believe in themselves now and who might just pull off one of the great escapes.
But just as Albion seemed to be on the right road, the wheels came off against Preston.
We gave ourselves self-doubt, I think, a number of times during this period.
We were fighting for it and working it out by the point, you know, by the minute, if not.
Another 2-0 defeat followed away at Leicester, where Mickey Adams was now in charge and celebrating promotion back to the Premiership. But a 1-1 draw against Sheffield Wednesday relegated the Yorkshire club along with Grimsby and meant there was still hope for the Seagulls going into the final home match against Watford.
And that's a beautiful pass into the feet of Kerry Mayo and Blackwell!
In that game again, it was just having got our nose in front and playing against teams who at the end of the season didn't have as much to play for. You know, I think it was important for us to get the points to give us that hope of surviving.
As the team romped to a 4-0 success, Stoke were beaten at Palace. Now the final day equation was clear enough. A win at Grimsby could keep Albion up, but they needed Stoke to lose their last game at home to Reading.
I think it's testament to, you know, to the whole group, to the football club, that we were still in with a shout after the start we had.
You know, the pitch, I always remember we went up there and the pitch was bone hard and it was a hot day. And
Hart. First chance to run at Grimsby, he goes down, Bobby Zamora.
I think we went for it, you know, I think we went for it.
It goes all the way through to Ingemarsson, struck by Zamora, and Callum, it is in. Now here's Neil, hacking by Watson and gets it and scores.
I suppose that was one match where the noises from the crowd told us very, very early that it didn't matter what we did, we were done.
It's gutting. When you've worked so hard over the 2 or 3 years before to build up to that season, everyone was looking forward to it, and then to go straight back down again, it was really hard to take.
One more game in the season, I think maybe two more games, we most definitely would have stayed up. To come down to the end like that was a bit of a kick in the teeth.
We gained a lot of experience that year, and it's something that as a footballer you have to go through.
Fell a little bit short, which is upsetting. You know, relegation is not a pretty thing to have to go through. But it comes with the territory. You know, when you're winning, everybody loves you and pats you on the back and wants to buy you a drink. And when you're down there, nobody phones you. But that's part of football, so you pick your chin up and you move on with life.
I think I said to the players after the game, you should be proud of your efforts. You know, disappointed, obviously, but certainly proud of your efforts, what you've done over the course of the season.
I just think back to, you know, injuries or games I missed, I was just thinking, if I was fit, you know, I might have been able to make a difference. and stay up, which would have been, you know, probably the biggest success that the club had had for a long time, you know. So no, I was extremely gutted to go down, but that's what.
All good things come to an end, but we knew by now you could never keep the Albion down for long. Still to come, the With Dean story continues as the fight to escape these humble surroundings heats up.
This really, really was a massive setback. I can't tell you how big a setback this was. The whole project was in danger.
Albion fans descend on Cardiff for a very special day out.
I said to Leon, I don't know if he said, the day before, I says, I'm going to get a penalty with 6 minutes to go, I said. And I says, you're not going to be able to take it.
And Leon Knight talks us through his acrimonious departure.
I was going through a real tough time at that time and with the manager and stuff. And you know, some things were justified what he was doing, but some things just wasn't.